Today on Sparrow News, we're talking to attorney Larry Saltzman with the public advocacy law firm known as Pacific Legal Foundation. He's going to be talking to us about a recent case that he's been advocating. Larry, can you tell us what exactly is this seawall controversy?
Well, this is a property rights case, and it involves a family that owns a mobile home park in San Clemente, California. That's a beach community in Southern California. They have a mobile home right on the beach, just right off the water. And the mobile home was aging. It was put in place over 40 years ago. It had mold and other things deteriorating. They wanted to replace it, and they needed to get a permit from the California Coastal Commission. But what the commission told them was that they will grant a permit so long as they agree to the condition, the family will agree to the condition, that they will never place any more, enhance or repair or rebuild that seawall that protects their property. It's totally unacceptable and really outrageous, because what it means is that over a period of years, their lot is going to erode, going to make that home uninhabitable. And the case really illustrates how property rights are about security and about prosperity.
What's the interest of the government in this issue?
Well, we would argue they really have no interest. The commission is just overreaching here to the point where mobile homeowners on the beach might spend more on legal fees to replace a mobile home than the cost of the actual home itself. But what's really going on is a larger policy battle. The California Coastal Commission, at least some members of the Coastal Commission, don't want to see man-made development on the beach like this. And the Coastal Act was passed in the 1970s. There was a lot of development in California that predates the Coastal Act, like this mobile home park. And the view of the commission is often that they just would like to see this go away. They can't demand that you take away your home. They can't simply deny you the right to use your land. That would be a taking. They'd be liable for condemning that property and paying for it, according to the U.S. and California constitutions. So the commission is really using a strategy to do what they think is the next best thing, which is let you use it in a way that the property will be destroyed by nature over time. The land will be cleared. They'll have what they view as a pristine coastline, no more man-made structure on it, and they won't have had to pay you for it. So this is a long-term strategy that the commission is employing to get what it wants, which is really the elimination of homes right on the beach like this.
You know, having homes on the beach like this, I know it would be wonderful, at least as an individual, to be able to look out the Pacific Ocean and see the sunset. But having a property on the beach, doesn't that mean that the public incurs an expense for things like rescue, should there be landslides and that sort of thing along in that area?
Well, there are laws in place, and we're not challenging them here, that deal with homes that are, say, built on bluffs that would create the kind of hazards or the kind of potential landslides that you're talking about. This is a nice flat portion of the beach with the homes right up against it. They do need to be protected by a seawall in order to be defended against, say, a direct wave strike during a particularly stormy period, or long-term against erosion. And we're not saying that the commission can't protect public resources. We support that. The legal principle involved is pretty simple and has been ratified time and again by U.S. Supreme Court and other courts, which is that when you condition a permit to use land like this, you can only place conditions on it that mitigate or offset or prevent some kind of harm from the private development encroaching on public resources. That's not happening here. We have a mobile home that has been in place for 60 years, the mobile home park. All we're doing is rolling out one mobile home, putting one in. There's nothing about this development that has any risk of enhancing the problem of erosion, of creating a new hazard, of requiring sand renourishment. There's nothing about this project that takes anything away from public resources, the public taxpayer. That's all we're saying, is that you should have a right to use your property so long as you use it in a way that doesn't encroach on others, that doesn't harm others, that doesn't cost the public. nothing about the Wills family's project. Eric Wills and his family own this mobile home is doing that.
And is this a case of unequal treatment? I mean, aren't there seawalls being successfully repaired and maintained and erected in other areas along the California coast?
Sure. And part of what's going on here, you can call it unequal treatment, discriminatory treatment, but it's part of this larger battle going on. California's Constitution and California's Coastal Act, which is the law that gives the Coastal Commission their authority, says that existing structures have a right to be protected by a seawall if they're in danger of erosion. And so a lot of these projects you see up and down the coast, you have owners that maybe have a home that is in perfectly good condition, but the seawall is eroding, and so the commission is letting them rebuild those. What they're doing in projects like the Wills project, like this mobile home project, is anywhere that they can get away from, get away with it, the commission is denying the right to let you enhance or repair a seawall at the time that you're asking for a permit to put a new home in place, like this new mobile home. So it ends up that some owners get treated very differently than others. That's unfair, but the commission is stuck giving some owners, I suppose, what they need to protect their property because the law is so clear that they can't deny it in those cases. Part of the point of this case is to create a precedent that protects all property owners up and down the coast.
And this would this go to the California Supreme Court, do you think?
Well, everything starts out in, you know, at a much lower level, and we're in the Orange County Superior Court. Orange County is, you know, a state court down here in Southern California. And we go to the Court of Appeals, probably win or lose. You know, either side is likely to appeal this. And ultimately, the California Supreme Court could accept review pending the outcome of the appellate court. We don't know how that will go, but Pacific Legal Foundation is committed to defending the Wills right and property right all the way up to the California Supreme Court, if that's what it takes.
Now, you know, as we know, I'm calling you from Michigan, and it's a long way from California, but it's a state that when it legislates, it has a ripple effect throughout the country. You know, California is no longer the only place where you can turn right on red, for example. So, you know, what are sort of the wider principles or wider issues, you know, for the rest of the country in this case?
Well, it's a good question. Pacific Legal Foundation litigates nationwide. People can look at our litigation program if they go to our website. It's pacificlegal.org, and including in Michigan. We have cases that we've litigated in Michigan. And Michigan, of course, has some pretty good lakes. And even though we're on the water here in the Pacific Ocean and you're just on the Great Lakes, these coastal land rights tend to be followed one state to another when they get established. And whether or not somebody has a right to protect their property against natural hazards is something that could easily migrate from California courts to other states. But the most important principle that's in common nationwide is this one dealing with permitting. The question is, when can the government demand from you a part of your property or that you waive your property rights as a condition of doing something ordinary and productive with your property, like adding on to it, you know, adding on to your home or replacing a mobile home? And what we say, what the U.S. Supreme Court has said, is that government can only condition a building permit where the condition is aimed at offsetting some kind of public harm, some kind of public hazard, some kind of public cost imposed on the community by the development. The California Coastal Commission is violating that principle here. Many municipalities, including cases that we've seen in Michigan, violate that municipality. And we'd establish that law at the U.S. Supreme Court, but often these cases arise in state courts, and so it's important in California and in Michigan to make sure that we litigate these through state courts and we get a uniform law that protects property owners to make ordinary and productive use of their property in ways that don't harm their neighbors.
Larry, how is this any different from, say, eminent domain?
I think it's related to eminent domain in a certain respect, which is that in the Wills case with their mobile home in San Clemente, if the California Coastal Commission had simply said, you may not use your land, they would have a viable claim for what's called inverse condemnation. That's a kind of case you file where you say, the government hasn't taken my property, but effectively they have, so I'm going to sue the government and make them pay for what they've effectively done. It's like in a domain in reverse. We would have a claim for that if the government simply said you can't use your property. Instead, they're trying to get the end, you know, limit the use of property in a kind of tricky way that avoids having to compensate anyone through the overregulation of the property. So sometimes when governments want you to do something with your property other than what you'd like to do with it, they don't want to pay you for it, so they don't want to condemn it. They don't want to take it by eminent domain. They just want to condition the way you use it so they get what they want without having to pay anything. And
what are some other instances of this tactic that you've seen elsewhere?
Well, I'll give you another example from another Pacific Legal Foundation case that I'm litigating in Palo Alto, California. In that case, we represent the Jesser family who owns a mobile home park. They want to close their park. They have a right to do that. They have a property right to the exclusive use of their property. They don't want it to be a mobile home park anymore. The owners are retiring. They've run the mobile home park for almost 40 years. They'd like to clear the land and maybe someday use it for another kind of development, like an apartment building or something that doesn't require them to manage it every day the way they do the mobile home park. And what the city of Palo Alto has said is, we don't want to condemn your property. You know, we don't want to take your property, but we don't want you to get rid of the mobile home park either, because it's providing affordable housing in the community. So what we're going to tell you, what they have told the Jesser family, is you may not close the park unless you pay your tenants $8 million so that they can afford housing elsewhere.
Wow.
And so effectively, it's the same idea.
Wow.
whether it's the Wills family or whether it's the Jesser family, when we go for a permit from the government to do something, in the Jesser family's case, it's closing a park, and the Wills family, it's replacing a mobile home on their land, the government kind of has you over a barrel. You're in a vulnerable position. You need to do something with your land that you want to do. You need to get their permission. And so they leverage that vulnerability to take something from you that they otherwise would not be entitled to. In the Jesser's, payments to their tenants. In the Wills case, a waiver of your right to protect your property down the road, which ultimately will mean they'll lose their property.
So it's like eminent domain through overregulation.
That's it. And in fact, what this is called in the law is a regulatory taking. In other words, it's not a physical taking. We're not physically going to take your property, but we're going to regulate it in such a way that effectively we're taking something from you.
That's right. I haven't really ever connected those dots. That's fascinating. Are there other cases like this that you know of in the United States?
Well, you know, I mean, there are definitely cases in California that we're fighting. We have other cases against the California Coast Commission that are battling the same thing effectively. All over the country, there are instances of regulatory takings. We had a case, for instance, a couple of years ago that went all the way to the United States Supreme Court out of Florida. A family by the name of Coots owned a piece of land that they wanted to develop, and their Florida Municipal Water Agency said that, who had the ability to grant or deny them a permit to develop their property, said, we'll let you develop your property so long as you pay us millions of dollars to create wetlands in an area that has nothing to do with your property. It was basically the same situation where they were saying, you're in a vulnerable situation. You want to develop your property. That's worth something to you. But we're going to withhold that permit unless you give us something, in that case, a lot of money, or in the alternative they offer, you could give us some land, as a condition of that permit. And it's just leveraging the permit power of the municipality to take something without compensation that the municipality would not be entitled to. And that's wrong, and it's unconstitutional.
What other more recent cases have you been involved in that involve property rights besides those that you've mentioned?
Well, Pacific Legal Foundation goes across the country, looking for and defending property rights cases. We have.
Do you see it as a trend?
Well, there's no question that for decades, property rights have been under attack by every level of government, federal, state, and municipal. And we get involved in cases from, say, environmental-related regulations that eliminate the use of your property or control the use of your property in ways that make it uneconomic. To give you an example of that, we had a case argued before the U.S. Supreme Court just last month. In that case, there's a family-owned farming operation. I guess I don't know if it's called mining or farming, but they mine peat. You know, they create peat bogs and they mine it. It's a landscaping ground cover. The federal government came in and said, "We think you're in a wetlands." The family said, "We don't think we are. We want to challenge that ruling." And what they learned is that the federal law gave them no right to take the federal agency, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers in that case, to court to determine whether or not the determination that they were in a wetlands was correct or incorrect, factually speaking, whether it was correct or incorrect, unless the family first went through a permitting process that would cost hundreds of thousands of dollars. And we thought, that can't be right. It can't be true that if the government comes in and says, you can't use your property because we think it's a wetland, but you don't think they're correct as a factual matter, you have no right to challenge that unless you first spend hundreds of thousands of dollars on a permit and get denied. So that case went all the way up to the Supreme Court. We expect it to be decided in the next couple of months. So you see cases like this where federal environmental legislation can dramatically affect and attack property rights. You have cases like our California Coastal Commission cases, or other coastal land rights cases that we've had in places like Florida or Texas that attack property. And we have local laws that will sometimes do the same. So we see attacks on property rights at all levels, and I do think it's been getting worse over the last few decades.
Well, I really want to thank you, Larry. This has certainly been an education for me and also one for our listeners, and I hope to get back to you as this this case unfolds. You and your colleagues at Pacific Legal Foundation have been very helpful in at least educating me on this topic. So I want to thank you very much.
Thank you. I would encourage your listeners and your readers to take a look at our website at pacificlegal.org. We have more than 100 cases going on at any given time in almost two dozen states at the same time, and I'm sure lots of your readers will find something interesting and educational going on in their state.
Thanks very much, Larry. We've been talking to Larry Saltzman of the Pacific Legal Foundation. You can find their website at pacificlegal.org. Thanks very much.